of what it is you're going to be looking into tonight.
Yeah, hi, thanks Bernard, and hello everyone who's listening, and thanks, can I may just say at the start, that after last time, just before Christmas was on, thanks for all the really nice emails I got from people, really did appreciate them. So yeah, I was thinking about it, and tonight I thought I'd talk a little bit about how to use your mind positively to overcome any fears or phobias you might have. And I'm going to teach you a technique you can use on yourself, but also on your family and friends, because it's completely safe and it's dead easy to put into action to overcome fears and phobias. And I thought then we could go to the other end of the scale and talk a little bit about a system I put together when I started off doing psychic readings. And I was particularly drawn to doing tarot cards, but all these books on what the descriptions of the cards are, it was like, I don't have a particularly wonderful memory, and I wanted a way of just bullet points of remembering what they were supposed to mean, but so that it also trigger off the unconscious part of our minds, so that, if you like, instantly things would jump into your head that were what I term as being the psychic intuition, gut feelings, call it what you will, that generally end up being the things that are incredibly accurate and help you to do a good reading for people.
Okay, so you're going to sort of reveal a secret tonight then, Jonathan, is that right?
Yeah, this is how to do it. If people have got a deck of tarot cards already, great, they'll be able to put this into action. If they haven't, yeah. This is something, once you hear what I'm about to say and think of it in your head as you hear me say the words, you'll instantly, once you've heard me say it once, you will know how to do basic tarot readings. Now, the reason I say basic is, to use an analogy I used last time I was on the show, we can all learn to play perhaps chopsticks on the piano, but we don't all necessarily become concert pianists. So, you know...
Good point, Jonathan. So if people have got pack of tarot cards out there, now is the time to get them and sit by the computers with them ready to have a listen to,
yeah,
how to go about it. It's easier if you've got them visually there with you, isn't it, really?
To an extent, but, you know, this is one of those things that once it's so ridiculously simple, that's my philosophy on life, as people who listened last time probably guessed, is too many people overcomplicate things, and if you can make them simple, it takes away all that frustration, all that complication, and sometimes fear that people have of learning something new. And it becomes easier then to put it into action, and the more you do it, the more you practice it, the better you become. That's just universal law of nature. So let's break down what a tarot deck is. Essentially, there's 78 cards in the deck, okay? And they fall into two groups. This is the only difficult bit to remember. 56 of those cards are what they call the minor arcana. They're the numbers and suit cards. And 22 of them are the major arcana. They're the picture ones with fancy names. So that's really the most difficult thing to remember. It gets easier from here on in. So the next thing to remember is, of the 56 minor arcana cards, they are in four suits, very much like a deck of cards has four suits. And the deck that I'm going to describe, that I've got in front of me physically now, is the Rider-Waite deck, which is the one I recommend for beginners, because it's, the pictures are so easy to look at, and it triggers off itself visually reminders of what the cards mean. But the four suits in this particular deck are Cups, Pentacles, Wands, and Swords. So you need to know what the suits mean. Now, these are stereotypical definitions. These are just memory aids. I'm not saying this, you know, you stick to this hard and fast, but this is how I got started. So the suit of Cups, I remembered the phrase, loving cups, or the old proverb of, my cup runneth over with love, to remind myself that the Cups card, the suit of Cups, is all to do with relationships and interactions with other people, whether that be family, friends, work, but it's interactions, it's relationships, that suit. Pentacles, it's dead easy to remember, because when you see the suit, you see these coins, that's what they look like, with the pentacle pictures on. It's coins, and that's what it is. Money, financial, material matters. So whenever you see a pentacle picture, you think material matters, money, finances, things like that. Then we've got the suit of wands, and on the particular deck I've got, which is the Rider-Waite deck here, when you see the wands pictures, and I'm just trying to find one, ironically, great, isn't it? When you want to find something, you never can. But essentially, the wands on most tarot decks, it's a wooden stick, a wand, or a staff, sometimes with a leaf or foliage on, and sometimes the end of it's sort of on fire, like the Olympic torch. So for wands, I think of the phrase, light up my life. So this is to do with the person's perspective and outlook, their social interactions, whereas the cup suit is to do with relationships on a more intimate nature. Wands is more social, people that may not be close family or loved ones. And then finally, the suit of swords is, oddly enough, a sword, which has two sides. One's sharp, one's dull, which reminds us there's two sides to every story. And when you cut through the air with a sword, it's like making a statement of, here I am. And so that statement is a communication. So that conjures up the mental image of swords are communications. It could be verbal communications. It could be written legal issues. It could be learning of something that's about to happen. But it's information. It's communications. So actually now, just off those four little bullet points, whenever you see a cup suit, you think, loving cup on my cup run over, it's close relationships. Pentacles is coins, it's money, material matters. Wands is social interaction, light up my life. Swords is two sides to every story, cutting through, making that statement, communication. So now you know what all the suits mean, basically. So now you need to know what the numbers mean. So forget the suits for a minute. We've got the numbers from 1 to 10, and this is dead simple. Number 1, it's the first number, so it's new beginnings. It's as simple as that. You'll never forget that now. Number 2, there's two people in a relationship. So that's what it is, it's relationships. Not necessarily just relationships of people together in a loving relationship, but it could be the relationship, business relationships, but it's relationships. For the number 3, any time I see the number 3, I think of the phrase, two's company, three's a crowd, to remind me of potential difficulties or conflicts in relationships and interactions with other people. Whenever I see a number 4, I think of four corners of a house, the four foundations, and it's foundations to be built upon in that particular area of life. For the number 5, I think of drawing a five-pointed star. And until you know how to do it, at first it's a bit difficult until you get the hang. So that's what it means. Number 5s are signifying difficulties in that area that need to be overcome. You need to find a new slant on things. For any cards with the number 6 on, you just think of throwing a dice several times in a row. And every time you keep getting the number 6 and you keep winning the money in the casino. So it's luck. It's signifying luck in that area. Whenever you see a number 7, think of the fact that, you know, at school and nurseries, up until the age of 7, really, it's all about setting people up for learning. They play games and it's simplistic ways of teaching them how to learn. From the age of 7, they start to learn properly. So it reminds me that the number 7, whenever I see it, is lessons to be learned in that area of life to move forward. For all the number 8s, I think of drawing a number 8. And if you take a pen and draw a number 8, your pen ends up back at the point where you started. So you've ended up, you've gone round in circles. So any number 8s are going round in circles, which then makes me think of the phrase, you know, two steps forward, one back. So it could be, you know, potential short-term limitations. Number 9s, all the number 9s are almost there, because there's only 10 numbers, so it's almost reaching a conclusion in that area, that issue. And number 10, being the final number, is the end result. It's something coming to an end, a conclusion. So now you know all the numbers. You actually know the meanings, numbers-wise, of 50 of the cards. So we've just got the picture cards now, which are page, knight, queen, and king. Forget about the suits again here. Paige, I always think of a younger female figure. I mentally connect the word Paige to a younger female that I know. So obviously you'd connect it to what you know in life. So the moment whenever Paige comes up, a Paige card, it triggers off the memory of this person you know and gives you ideas of character traits and things that might be going on in their life. And bizarrely, call it fate, coincidence, whatever, I found that doing that, quite often there will be a lot of similarities in that area of life of what's going on for the person you're doing the reading for. For all the night cards, I think of a younger male. By younger, I mean sort of, you know, from anywhere from birth to sort of middle age. A younger male for knight. For queen, guess what? I bet you're ahead of me now. An older female is what I think of. And for king, I think of, you've got it already, an older guy. And that's whatever page, knight, queen or king it is of any suit. So you actually now know the meanings of 56 of the cards, the minor arcana, because you know the meanings of the numbers, the meanings of the court cards, and the meanings of the suits. And the irony of it is, if you take your tarot deck and, you know, the mixed up, and somebody takes cards out and books them in whichever spread you choose to use, many of which you can find on the internet, when you turn over the card, let's take one at random here. I've just taken out the, let me count it up, 3, 6, the 10 of wands. So immediately I know the number 10 is a conclusion, or end result, because it's the last number. Wands, I remember the fire, the staff in the life, the social interactions, the memory aid from before. So it's something coming to a conclusion in the area of social interactions. You just link what the number means to what the suit means. And you do this with each card you see in front of you. And then logically, that gives you bits of the jigsaw, because you may be doing, say, a 12-card reading. You go through each card in turn, explain briefly what it means based on the suit and the number, or whether it's page, knight, queen, king. And then you can link those bits of the jigsaw together, and amazingly, again, call it fate, call it coincidence, but I found it becomes amazingly, uncannily accurate to what the person was merely mentally thinking of. I'll point out here, I never ask people to verbally tell me what it is they're asking the tarot. I ask them to keep that to themselves until after the reading, so I can sort of test myself how accurate it's been. And it's amazing how accurate it can be. So actually that's how to remember the 56 minor arcana cards. So all you've got left is the major arcana, the picture cards, as you will, which I'm going to go through in order from 0 up to 21. There's 22 of them, but the Fool is classed as 0 because it's the beginning of life's journey, so to speak. And all we're going to do here is conjure up mental images to trigger off thought patterns in our mind so that our unconscious kicks in, because it works on symbolism. And because the unconscious kicks in with a little memory aid, that memory aid will distract our conscious mind long enough that you could argue we go into a bit of a mini trance state, almost like hypnosis, and you will find that things just jump into your head that you find yourself saying, which far expand on the simple memory aid and will be amazingly accurate to the person in front of you. So starting with the Fool, just think of the Fool, and when you see the image, think of fool, folly, doing something stupid, making foolish mistakes, and having to learn from past mistakes. That's it. That's the only memory aid I think of. The Fool, it's self-explanatory. And whatever jumps into your head off that little memory aid, say it. Go with your gut instinct. That's your intuition. If it's, you know, if it's, you feel you need to say it. You'll be right. The next card is the Magician. Now, for this, I think of Paul Daniels. Oh, you'll like it. Not a lot. People in America might want to think of David Copperfield or David Blaine. But I think of a conjuring trick magician who's using sleight of hand to deceive us. Sometimes in an entertaining manner, but sometimes you get dishonest magicians as well who use sleight of hand to rip people off. So the Magician is someone who is very skillful and have these skillful abilities to deceive us, but in some situations they can be used positively, others they can be used negatively, and your gut instinct will tell you where to go with that, but that will set your thinking. The High Priestess, I think of somebody who is very judgmental, because in the Rider-Waite deck you have a picture of someone sort of sat there with a cross, a religious cross, and to the left hand side of them is a pillar with B on in black, and to the right hand side is a white pillar. It's all about balance, judgment, right and wrong. Someone who's very judgmental. I think everyone knows somebody in life who's like that. So think of a mental image of that person you know in life who's like that. Look at the High Priestess card, and remember, every time you see the High Priestess card, think of that person you know in your life who's like that, and you start describing what's going on to them, the way they're treating people, and amazingly, it tends to be right for the person in front of you. The Empress, I get a mental image of somebody I know in my life who's an older female who's very good at giving advice, the kind of person people go to when they've got a problem, always sorting things out for other people, never seems to have enough time for themselves because they're always, you know, more interested in helping others than taking care of themselves. And I link that image of that person I know in my life to the Empress card, so every time I see the Empress card, up pops that image of the person I know for real. I describe what's going on to them, and go with whatever jumps into my head from there on in. With the Emperor, similar to the Empress, except I think of an older male I know in life who has the similar attribute to being a good listener, giving good advice, helping to sort things out. And that's the mental image that pops up when I see the Emperor and sets me going. The Hierophant, or as it's sometimes called in some tarot decks, the Pope, that's what I think of. The Pope, a religious person. A person who tries to preach, to live your life properly and you know, and do good, don't do bad. And that sets me off, and then you're into your sort of mini trance and you just say the first thing that comes into your head. The Lovers, pretty self-explanatory really. You look at the card, there's a man and a woman on it. He said it all, the Lovers. Just think of whatever image is positive for you in terms of love, relationships, etc. The Chariot. Running a chariot race was always very difficult. People got hurt, but if they managed to get to the finishing line, especially if they were first, they won praise, they won awards, they won prizes. It was worth all that effort. So I always think of a chariot race and the fact that this could signify that the person's got an issue going on in their life, that there's obstacles in the path, but they've got to keep at it, because as long as they keep at it, keep focused, keep positive, they will get to that finish line and they will reap the rewards for it. So just chariot equals chariot race, and it sets you off in the right direction. Strength, I just think of the phrase inner strength, needing and having that inner strength to overcome obstacles in life. The Hermit, as the card, well, certainly in the Rider deck, it's sort of a cloaked figure with a lamp in his hand who sort of shut off from the rest of the world, isolated, secretive, shy, depressed maybe. All these words come to mind, and that's what then jumps into my head from there, is what I would say. But you just need those bullet points to jump into your mind consciously, so that then unconsciously you'll just start having things jump into your head, and that's what to go with. The Wheel of Fortune, I think of the British television game show. I think there's the same thing in America as well. The Wheel of Fortune, when they spin the Wheel of Fortune, they can win good prizes sometimes. Sometimes they win bad ones. Sometimes they don't win anything at all. And it's a metaphor for life. And the fact that, you know, sometimes things are a gamble. Sometimes you have to take that gamble to achieve something worthwhile. And that sets you off on a path. Justice, I think of the law courts. And, you know, the scales of justice, which is easy to remember because on most of the tarot decks, the person on there is holding the scales. And they could weigh in favour of the person or against, but the other cards around it, and I'll come to that in a minute, will give you an idea where to go, as will your instinct. The Hangman generally shows somebody hung upside down. So I think all the blood rush to the head, which makes them feel lightheaded, confused, and that's what it reminds me, is confusion about something, which way to go, overcoming the mistake that's been made. Death is the end of the old, start of the new. And, you know, in tarot readings, I make it clear, death, generally speaking, doesn't mean that they're going to drop off the chair and die. It just means that it's the end of something, the start of something new. Temperance, it's moderation in all things. And on the Rider-Waite deck, it's somebody pouring liquid from one cup into another, and looking a little bit befuddled as they do it, almost like a recovering alcoholic going, there's lots of alcohol here, but I'd better not drink it. So that's what it is. Moderation in all things is the way to go. The devil, literally, just think of the devil. If you've seen the film Bedazzled, think of the mischievous devil and an outside influence causing problems and potentially getting in the way of things being done right. The tower, you just have to look at the picture. It's a big tower. It's got no doors on it. And yet there's people diving out of the windows. How did they get in there? It must have been difficult. It must have been a big climb up there. So it's difficulties. It's problems. It's having to put in that effort. The star, I just think of the phrase, wish upon your lucky star. It's about following your dreams, your ambitions, about keeping focused and positive, putting the past behind you, putting negativity behind you, moving towards that brightness, and making your dreams come true. The moon, on the card, you've got the little wolves at the bottom, and just as the moon can affect the wolf when it's a full moon and make it moody, so that's what I think of. There's a situation around the person at that time that may be causing confusion or frustration or anger, and that's what they've got to address and overcome. So I just think of the way the moon affects the wolf. The sun, just think of the sun in the sky and the fact that it's necessary to make new plants grow. It's necessary to all elements of life. It's about growth, renewed energy, positivity, brightness. It's as simple as that. All these bullet point words will come to you when you see it from now on in. We then have judgment. The picture says it all. On the Rider-Waite deck, there's loads of people at the bottom. They're almost looking up to this angel in the sky with a horn, going, give me the answer, please, give me the answer. And that's what it sets me off thinking, judgment. There's a decision to be made, but they're going to have to seek advice from elsewhere, just like the people on the picture image on the tarot card are doing. And finally, at the major arcana, the world. I just think of the phrase, the world's a wonderful place. Now, we all at times feel somewhat slightly differently than that, but I feel that it's important when doing a tarot reading for somebody to try and keep it as positive and upbeat as possible. But it will automatically set you off. So now you actually, by looking at any of the cards, these keywords will pop into your head and you will know where to go. Because you'll be focused on those keywords, your unconscious mind will kick in and suggest other things to you, which arguably is a trance state, or is it the state of intuition? I'll leave that for others to decide, but I found that combining those bullet points together means that even a beginner can pick up a deck of tarot cards, get the person to give them a good mix, maybe pick out a dozen of them, and they can give a really detailed reading and actually amaze not just the client, but themselves with how accurate it is. And there's one final little tip on tarot reading, is get your tarot deck, give them a good shuffle so they're in a random order, and put them on the table in front of you. Turn them over one at a time, so you turn over one, see whatever it is, doesn't matter what it is, look at it, see the image, get a clear impression of what that image is, and then close your eyes and see that image in your mind's eye. And just imagine for a few minutes that you're walking around in that image in your mind's eye, and have a look at what's off the edge of the card that isn't printed on it. Yeah, you'll be creating this in your own imagination, but here's the beauty. Once you've created it once, purely imaginary, in your conscious mind, whenever you see that tarot card again in the future, those memories, those creations that your instinct, your conscious mind collectively made up, when you did this mini meditation for a minute or two on each of the tarot cards in turn, will be stored in your unconscious mind and immediately come out. And guess what? Because you created it and it felt right for you, it will be right. And you're just, it's like a fast-track way of tapping into your own innate psychic intuition ability that we're all born with. Put that all together, and I personally believe that's the fastest, quickest, most effective way to get started reading tarot cards, because then when you start doing it, you've come to trust in your own intuition, and just say what comes to mind, and hopefully that will be of use to some people, Bernard.
Absolutely, yeah, that's a really good way of explaining it, and it's one that you can follow, because when you look at the instructions ordinarily, the ones you get with a regular pack of tarot, and right away it's a very common one, it's quite, the instructions are quite complicated, and most people give up before they've even started because the instructions seem so complicated. So that's a really good way of explaining it all.
Which, you know, it's a shame because of that overwhelming, oh crikey, there's all this to learn, it puts people off. Yet if they just managed to get the hang initially, then they'd learn to trust their own intuition. And that's what I really like about it. Tip two, and this isn't tarot, I'm going to teach you now in the space of 2 minutes, astrology. How to meet a complete stranger and tell you what star sign they are, and then you can give them a pretty detailed and pretty damned accurate character reading of what they're like, the way they feel, and roughly what's going on to them. And it's simplicity itself. Get a piece of paper and a pen, write down the 12 star signs. If you can't remember what they all are, just pick up a newspaper or a magazine and find the astrology page. Write them down, then go through your diary or your calendar or your Facebook account in this modern age, and find somebody you know really well who is, for example, a Leo. Find someone who's a Sagittarian. In other words, find somebody for each of the star signs that you know really well, and link their face to that star sign. So whenever you encounter somebody who says, for example, they're a Leo, in your head jumps up the picture of the person you know who's a Leo in your life, and you describe the character traits, the personality traits, the kind of things they do and have been going on in that person you genuinely know, what's been going on in their life, and you know what I found? Call it fate, call it coincidence. It's like 99% accurate the majority of the time. And it can be a great lead-in before you go into your tarot readings and stuff. And also it gives you the confidence then to rely on that natural instinct we've all got to just say the first thing that comes into our head without the fear of failure, because it's fear that often puts people off. And another weird thing I found, ask somebody what their first name is. It doesn't matter what it is. So in your case, let's try this as an experiment. First, Bernard. So I'm just going to double check. I'm guessing your name is it spelled B E R N A R D?
That's right. Yeah.
Okay. So once I knew that and I clarified with the person in front of me how it was spelled. So in your case, Bernard. Yep, it's B E R N A R D. I'd take each letter in turn, and I'd say the first thing that came into my head that could relate to everyday life, relevant to that letter. So for B, the first thing that jumps into my head is books. So that would lead me to instinctively link and connect in my head, why would books be relevant? And now I actually already know you've written books, but if it wasn't, if I didn't know that, I'd be inclined to say that the chances are you're very much of a knowledge seeker, the kind of person who believes that, you know, a poor sort of family is one with loads of money, whereas a rich family is one that's got lots of knowledge and books available, because knowledge helps us learn. And I just go with the first things that entered my head off that word that I'd created from the first letter of your name, and then we go to the second letter, E. That actually makes me want to, the first word that comes to mind there is education or eccentric. No offence, but I'm just... Those are the two words that come to mind to the letter E for me. So I think education, perhaps you should expand things in the realm of teaching others. Perhaps it's something you've looked at doing more of. Eccentric, perhaps some people think you have a weird way of approaching things sometimes, but that's fine because it works for you. And essentially what you do is you just take each letter of their name in turn, think of the first word that comes into your head starting with that letter, And then when you've got that word, just think of the first situation in life that seems relevant to that and say it. And I found again, call it fate or coincidence, that it tends to be relevant to that person in front of you. But all those three together, the astrology, the letters of the name becoming a word, and then whatever image comes up with that word, together with your memory aids for a deck of tarot cards, and, you know, listeners, you'll be doing amazing readings incredibly quickly and learning to rely and have confidence on your own intuition.
Yeah, I can see that. They're all very, very good ways of remembering the tools that you need for basic readings, and I've never heard it put like that before. So, it's something else we've learned here at Psychic Radio, Jonathan. Thanks a lot.
No problem. It's just that's what I love doing. I just like to because I'm a bit thick, actually, to be honest, you see. And I'm thick and lazy. So I can't do with all this complication. If I do find something complicated, I just like to find easier ways around it, because and then I'll be sharing them with people. So hopefully that'll have been of use to some listeners out there, and they can have some fun with that. And I'm not certain, one thing I never asked you is, can people listen to this show again after it's been aired?
Oh, absolutely, yeah. It will be recorded like your previous show and played throughout the week, probably at least once a day.
Great, so yeah. People can have a chance if they want to sit down with a piece of paper and a pen and perhaps take a few bullet point notes if they want, before they go and buy a deck of tarot cards and try this out. So that's brilliant. So moving along then, I'd love to share with you, because I know we've only got a limited amount of time. Last time we were on air, I spoke about using saliva in your mouth and certain phraseology and affirmations to control pain, and we spoke a bit about how the mind worked. I'd like to share a technique for eliminating fears and phobias from your own life and other people's lives. Now, listeners at home, if you've got a phobia of something, you can actually, because I'm going to run through this, what I say and ask you to visualise is exactly what you would do to yourself, except obviously you just mentally go through the process, or it's what you would actually repeat in your own words that you feel comfortable with, of course, to a friend to get them to do it, because it's just a mental visualisation process that's completely safe, and as long as it's done the way we're about to do it, it has amazing results for the majority of people. So we're going to do it. So if you've got something that concerns you, whether it's a fear of spiders, heights, whatever, that's what I'd like you to think about when I say think of the phobia or fear you had. If you haven't, just pay attention, take notes, I'll listen to it again next time and take the bullet points, and you can help other people with this. But this is what they call the fast phobia cure, and it goes something like this. So, as you sat at home, what I'd like you to do, knowing that you're safe at all times, is just to think of that thing or situation that you currently have labelled as being a fear or a phobia. And interestingly, as you just take a few moments to remember what that is, I'll just point out to you that fear is actually an acronym for false evidence against reality. Because that's all fears are. It's just you've come to believe that when you see, for example, a spider, that you're going to be scared. And the more you've done it, the better you've become at being scared. Because you practice it loads of times. So now it's just a case of becoming really good at not being bothered in any way. And you know, the opposite emotion to fear is laughter. And if you can laugh about something that once bothered you in the past, it no longer bothers you in any way, shape or form. And that's what's fantastic about this. So when you think of a time in the past when that thing bothered you, worried you or concerned you, or actually scared you to some level, on a scale of 0 being no problem whatsoever, and 10 being the worst that ever was in the past, mentally think to yourself how high up that scale, how close to 10 or maybe beyond 10 for some people, it was or is when you've encountered that. And when you've remembered that, made a note of it so that you can prove to yourself later that a change has taken place for you. Then just close your eyes and imagine yourself, knowing that you're safe at all times, just imagine yourself walking into a big cinema and you've got a private screening room. And you're going to walk into this cinema and sit down in a chair, a lovely comfortable chair, somewhere near the front, one of those VIP ones, the really comfy fancy ones. And in front of you is the big screen, and you realise you're all alone there. You're safe, calm and secure, but it's just you on your own. And then a strange thing happens. Just imagine in your mind's eye, it's a little bit like astral projection, a strange feeling of starting to float up out of your body and moving backwards in the room. So you, in a few moments' time, imagine it's almost as if you find yourself in the projection room. And you're looking out through the projection room, little window there, and you can see the back of your head. Yes, you can see yourself sat in the cinema. It's almost as if your spirit, your soul's moved out of your body, floated back in the room of the cinema into the projection booth, and is now staring out through the little window, looking down at the back of your head of yourself, looking at the screen. And as you do, just lean forward and touch the glass in the projection room, which just proves to yourself you're calm, safe and secure there, and you're completely removed in any way from those emotions or feelings that once bothered you in the past. And then as you watch as an observer from the projection room, I'd like you to imagine that you start a film running on the screen. And this film is a little movie of a time in the past when your fear or your phobia bothered you. And when I count to three, on the count of three, this film's going to start running from the beginning, the moment just before you encountered the thing that once used to scare you or bother you. And then it's going to run through you encountering it, being scared of it as you once were in the past, to the point where you get to the end, you're no longer in that environment, you're no longer scared or worried or concerned, and you're starting to calm down and realising that you're alive, you're okay, you're safe, you feel good again, you're feeling control again. Okay, so you're going to run it from the beginning, just before it happens, to where afterwards, after it's happened, where you feel safe again. So 1, 2, 3, just let the movie run from the beginning, and you encounter it, and then to the end. But pretty quick. Fantastic. In fact, that's quick enough. Just open your eyes a moment. Fantastic. Break state. And now just close your eyes again. See yourself once again in the projection booth. Touch the glass again to prove to yourself you're nice and safe. Look through that little glass window. Imagine seeing the back of your head of you physically sat in the cinema looking up at the screen. And this time, it's all going to happen completely differently. Because what I'd like you to do is remember that image of at the end when you felt fantastically safe again and that sense of relief, and almost freeze frame it. So it's like just a still photograph. And then imagine all the colour draining out of it so it becomes a black and white photograph. That's brilliant. And now imagine positioning that in the bottom right hand corner of the screen as you're looking at it. Take a few moments to do that in a way that feels right for you. That's wonderful. And next I'd like you to rewind in your mind and remember the image you had on that film just before you encountered, before you knew you were going to encounter that thing that once bothered you in the past. Take a freeze frame of that. So at the moment, you're happy, you feel fine because nothing's happened. Take a freeze frame shot of that, drain all the colour out so it becomes a black and white image, and then position that in the bottom left hand of the screen. That's brilliant. So now you're in that projection booth, you can touch the glass again, prove to yourself you're safe there, nothing bothers you, worries you as it once did in the past. You're looking down at the back of your head, you're looking up at the screen, and that screen you can see on the bottom right hand corner, a freeze frame, black and white image of after the event, where you're completely calm, safe, secure and feel fantastic. And on the bottom left hand of the screen you can see a small little freeze frame image in black and white of you before you ever encountered this, where it doesn't bother you, worry you or concern you in any way, shape or form. And here's what's going to happen, okay? On the count of three, this time when you press the projector in the projection booth and you look up at the screen, you're going to see, starting from the right-hand side of the screen, that freeze frame image of after the event is suddenly going to get bigger, fill up the screen, but it's in black and white, and it's going to run the movie you ran before, but backwards, okay? To the point where it gets to the beginning, and then it's going to immediately get smaller again and move down into the small image on the left-hand side of the screen, which is then going to get huge and big and become the full screen where you were before the event, where it hasn't even happened yet. So we're going to move from after the event, becomes full screen, runs backwards. The film, as though it's broken down, it's running backwards. You'll hear the voices going like little daft cartoon characters. The image will seem really daft and really stupid. In fact, you'll notice how daft that seems as you run it back in your mind, to the point where it gets right to before the event, and that image becomes the big screen, and it's like nothing ever happened, nothing bothered you, worried you, or concerned you in any way. So on the count of three, you're going to do that, and I'm going to make a ridiculous attempt at making the noise of like the Benny Hill theme tune, which you're going to link together with this image. So on the count of three, one, two, three, start that image big, running backwards now. Backwards, backwards. And quickly back to the beginning, so that image gets big as it was before the event, but it's still black and white, so that it's not even happened yet. That's fantastic. That's time one. We spoke last time about the human mind needing to do things three times so that the unconscious mind listens. So this time, again, on the count of three, we're going to start with the image on the bottom right-hand of the screen after the event, getting big, film running backwards, so you can see the images going backwards, staff voices, like cartoon character. Silly music, in fact, it seems daft doing it. It might bring a smile to your face now. You're thinking, what's this all about? But that's fantastic. And at the end, you'll end up getting that image from before the event, filling the screen nice and big. So here we go. One, two, three, and start. Now. I'm running it backwards. Back to the beginning. See, big screen, black and white, before the event. Nothing bothers you, worries you, or concerns you. And we're going to go for a final time, but this final time, I'd like you to think of your favourite comedian, someone who really makes you laugh. It can be more than one person if you want. Quite common is Morecambe and Wise, or Double X from the past. It can be a film comedian, but it could be someone you just know from real life, but someone who really makes you laugh. When you think of them, you think, yeah, they make me laugh. And I want you to imagine that they've entered the cinema, and they're stood at the bottom left-hand corner of the cinema screen. This time, okay? And they've got a big, massive comedy hoover in their hands. Something like you might see on a cartoon, because what's going to happen this time is you're going to start that image rolling from the bottom right-hand corner of the screen after the event. It's going to get big, full screen, run backwards like it did before, but this time as it starts running backwards, you're going to realise your favourite comedian's at the bottom left-hand corner of the screen, and they're going to turn that hoover on, and they're going to start sucking that memory and that issue that once bothered you in the past into the hoover, removing it completely so it doesn't bother you, worry, or concern you as it did in the past. In fact, you'll find it really, really funny. Okay? So here we go on the count of three. One, two, three. Met that image running backwards. The voice is going. And it's. And your favourite comedian sucking that hoover. That's seen sucking that image off the screen. So it's sucking to the bottom left hand of the screen, and it's going into the hoover, and it's sucking into the hoover. And just take a few moments to get it all sucked into the hoover, all sucked into the hoover. And then just let the whole image disappear completely in your mind's eye. That's fantastic. Open your eyes, blink a couple of times. That's brilliant. Take a nice deep breath in. And then out. And then, here's the strange thing. If you just close your eyes and try to think of that thing that bothered you in the past to the same intensity it was in the past, and try to experience the feelings that you did before we've tried this exercise, and be totally honest with yourself, you notice that when you try to think of it, actually, you know, when you suddenly start thinking of your favourite comedian sucking that image out of the screen and it running backwards and daft voices and the Benny Hill theme tune and all these daft things, and you just feel different than you did before. And if you think about it on a scale of 0 to 10, 0 being no problem whatsoever, 10 being the worst it ever was, you can see for yourself how much lower you've gone. Some people it goes the first time they do that exercise. Other people need to do the exercise maybe first thing in the morning when they get up. I spoke about last time when we just wake up, we're incredibly suggestible and in a receptive state of mind. And last thing at night just before we go to sleep when we feel tired. Once again, you've got more direct line, so to speak, of communication to your unconscious, where you can reprogram your personal laptop computer. And that is literally the fast phobia cure.
Well, that was absolutely fascinating, entertaining, and a thrilling way to learn how to get over your phobias. It's really, really something that you can listen to and really get into. I do see that you could do with, you know, listening to that a few times to really fully appreciate it. I can see that the first time it's a little bit fast moving, but I can understand that it has to be in order for it to, you know, to, for you to complete the process and not only...
To distract your conscious mind,
yeah,
really.
Yeah, keeps the concentration, keeps people listening as well, doesn't it? Fantastic, yeah.
And, you know, the steps for that are in my book, Confessions of a Hypnotist, which if people would like to send me an email on royle@magicalguru.com. I'll be more than happy to send them an email back with a link where they can download that book, which contains the phobia cure and other useful stuff in, no charge whatsoever.
Well, you can't get better than that. You can't get better than that. Oh, I think we're very privileged to have you on here, Jonathan.
Thank you very much indeed, Bernard. It's been an absolute pleasure.
Yeah, it's been a pleasure listening to you, as I've said, entertaining, thrilling to listen to. It actually, what you've done tonight, I think, is you've given us, which I think is imperative in this day and age, because I think that we kind of are told how to think from an early age, and to listen to someone like yourself that's kind of in a way unleashing the potential for people to be able to think how they want to and release themselves from phobias and restrictions and things that stop them from doing what they really want to do. I mean, that's something else. You know, you're empowering people in order for them to be able to live their lives and do what they want to do from the way in which they want to think, and that, you know, all credit to you. It's fantastic.
Thank you. That's the key. Be positive. Simple as that.
Yeah. Great. So, I'm sure we'll have you back on here again, Jonathan.
It'll be a pleasure, Bernard.
I'm sure after today, after tonight, they'll be emailing in and wanting to know when. But we'll keep you posted, and for people listening in, they can always look on the programme schedule, which has been updated again.
Yeah, and if there's any particular areas of life or health issues or anything that any of the listeners would like some sort of tools or strategies towards, perhaps they'd like to email you, and then before next time, you can let me know and we can sort of deal with what listeners want.
Yes, perfect.
Brilliant. Thank you very much indeed, Bernard.
Thank you, Jonathan.
Take care.
Can you just hold the line there, Jonathan?
Been alone with you inside my mind, and in my dreams I've kissed your lips a thousand times. I sometimes see you pass outside my door. Hello, is it me you're looking for? I can see it in your eyes, I can see it in your smile. You're all I've ever wanted, and my arms are open wide. Cause you know just what to say, and you know just what to do, and I want to tell you so much. I love you. Sunlight in your head, and tell you time and time again how much I care. Sometimes I feel my heart will overflow. Hello, I've just got to let you know, cause I wonder where you are, and I wonder what you do. Are you somewhere feeling lonely, or is someone loving you? Tell me how to win your heart, for I haven't got a clue.
And how about that then? All you out there in psychic cyberspace, what did you think of that, Dr. Jonathan Will? Absolutely fantastic, upbeat, positive. And like I was just saying, you know, it's a way of releasing your mind from phobias and empowering yourself to enable yourself to think the way in which you want to think. Never underestimate the power of positive thought. And what I like about Jonathan's style is, you know, I think his motto of keep it simple, stupid, which he mentioned last time, is absolutely spot on, because, you know, I like this way of keeping things simple, using imagery to improve your memory, because that's, you know, it's a tried and tested formula that in recent years has become very popular in business, and I think that people now all over in everyday life are actually using it to empower themselves in order to be able to remember things easily. And I think it has to be said, though, when we look at the tarot cards, you know, we have to go back to what Jonathan was saying. You do have to remember that you're going to have great fun using the techniques there if you've got your own tarot and you can listen to this again and practice it. But practice does make perfect, and it also takes a little bit of, you know, a natural ability, and people range from being able to like in music, play with one finger, all the way to concert pianists. So you can get fun out of the tarot and looking at it in that way, but you know, don't expect to become a concert pianist overnight, and expect, you know, if you want to get really good at it, to have to put the time in, the practice in, and also to have a natural ability, which, you know, some people have got and some people haven't. But don't worry if you haven't got it in that area, then you may have it in another. You know, astrology may be your thing. There's many different things that you can look at. And Jonathan's really opened up our minds tonight to look at methods which are actually termed as divination, in the methods of divination in regard to looking at our situations in life, past, present and future. Because of course, you know, when you're looking at the tarot, we have to take into account one perhaps thing that maybe Jonathan left out there, is that you know, we do have three different dimensions, past, present and future, and that is something that you divinate, or you become aware of through experience, really. You kind of get drawn in certain directions, and I suppose that's sort of like having an ear for music. It's like being able to listen to middle C and say, oh, that's a middle C, and that's an F. You know, some people can do that and some people can't. Some good basic advice there in how to learn things quickly. And I think that those same sort of methods could be applied into different areas of life, which could otherwise be, you know, quite complicated. You can simplify things, and I think that basic philosophy is really important. I studied into tarot myself in the past over a number of years. I can't say that I necessarily use that particular technique, but the names that Jonathan has been describing for the different cards there, you know, it's a good way, and the figurative way in which he was putting figurative images to those particular cards, I think, again, really, really good. It's really, you know, makes it easy to remember exactly what he was saying there. My particular tarot cards are taken from the Salvador Dali pack, and each image on the cards has got the sort of intricate, sort of complex pattern on. There's not too many of the packs about now. They stopped actually printing them at one point and then started again, I believe. I'm not sure whether they're still printing them again now. But also, over a period of time in my office in New Street, Birmingham, in the UK, developed a a unique layout, because, well, spread actually, because the layout of the cards is called a spread, and there are actually different types of spreads that you can use. There's one that springs to mind is the, you know, the Celtic cross, and then there's the horseshoe. You know, there's different actual names to how you lay these tarot cards out as well. Just to extend a little bit on what Jonathan was saying, the way that I kind of got drawn to work through my spirit guides, because obviously I sort of built up my rapport, if you like, with my spirit guides before working with tarot, so I had the benefit, you know, the fortunate benefit of their influence, really, which obviously helped me tremendously with the tarot. But as Jonathan was saying, it's quite amazing how accurate they can actually come out. And sometimes I like to use them when I'm trying not to be biased. So if it's something that's particularly close to myself, then I might have a little look on the tarot card rather than totally communicating with my spirit guides, because, you know, I suppose my free will can argue with them a little bit when it's something directly connected with myself. You know, when they tell you something for you, you tend to think, well, you know, and you try to bend it a little bit, you try to sort of say, do I have to do that? You know, perhaps there's a way around it, and you start putting free will into it in your own conscious mind. So tarot can be very good for kind of looking at things, you know, directly connected with you if you are experienced, but I wouldn't recommend that for people that are not experienced. And I have encountered in the past people that have become rather addicted at looking at their own futures with their own tarot cards, and that actually is quite a negative thing to do if you do it too frequently. The problem there is, especially if you're not using them to look at other people's situations, only your own, is that the energy can become like a stagnant pool. Before I actually explain that, I'll just also say the spread that I used is called a Scorpio spread, and it's sort of shaped in the Scorpio sign. I briefly mentioned it in the book Divina Spiritus, I'm sure, at one point. So I kind of lay them out in the shape of a scorpion, so it sort of goes around and has a tail on it. So I suppose it could be argued that you could have a reading with a bit of a sting in the tail there, but I honestly didn't think of it in that way when it was created. I didn't think of it at all. It was just laid out. It was almost as, you know, when I do automatic writing or drawing, it was kind of in that sort of fashion or format that kind of way of working with tarot came out. But just coming back to the situation where you can look at your own cards without doing readings for other people too regularly, which is something that perhaps you can get into, it can be addictive. And as I've said, it's not a good thing, because you have to remember that when you're working with anything on a psychic level, you're working with energy flow. So if you look at your own all the time, you don't use them for someone else, then you get what's called, or what I call, the stagnant pond effect, because the energy is going out into the cards in front of you and back to you. You have to imagine it going in a sort of a circle. Then you're using your own energy, and that energy isn't able to be cleansed in the same way as, for example, running water would be. So you have to imagine the energy, I suppose, in a similar context to water, and realize that when you look at something like that, it's okay a few times, but unless you have somebody else sitting in front of you, which is the usual way for tarot to be used, then you're not getting the effect of the energy going from you to the cards to the other person, and then back to the cards and you. So the energy flow, which ordinarily would occur in such circumstances when you're reading the tarot for someone, doesn't occur. So if you are reading for somebody else, then the energy gets purified like a running stream, like a, you know, pond that's got water running through it. And so it pays to remember that, because if the water becomes stagnant, if you every single day start looking at your cards, which you know it's easy to get into, it's very, very easy to start thinking, well, what's going to happen today, especially if you're in an anxious situation, and then you can think, well, I'll have another look tomorrow, I'll have another look the day after, you know. And I've known people look 5 or 6 times a day and more. And what happens is you kind of get the stagnant pond effect. So the replies that you start getting back from your tarot cards become negative. You know, they can become the opposite to what really is going to happen, you know, and they can contradict themselves. Because once the energy gets negative, then, you know, you're kind of doing yourself more harm than good. So bear that in mind. It's not a good idea to use them in that way. So energy flow is important to remember, and dimensions, past, present and future, comes in time. That's something that you have to kind of use your intuition with, and you know, also following a specific layout. It's not a good idea to sort of develop your own layout, I don't think, if you're a beginner. I think that's really best done, you know, at a more advanced stage. If you then wish to develop your own style, it's okay, but initially it pays really to develop your abilities, as you would again with a comparison with music. If you was learning the guitar, you learn the chords, you hold the guitar in a certain way, you know, there's the right way of doing things. It's the same as, you know, when you learn to drive. So it's best really to start off in a way that's conventional, and then if you want to develop your own style, which of course, you know, most people do anyway, as again with driving, you know, you tend to kind of develop little styles, your own techniques, your own style, which then can come naturally in at a later date. But it's good practice really to start off following through with a formal format. So didn't actually know we'd be sort of talking about tarot tonight, so that's really interesting. Now, you can email me, and I can get the emails at the moment whilst I'm on air, at bernard@ilsley.com. My other email address I can only access when I'm on the other computer, and as those of you that have been listening in rest frequently and recently will know that I've had a bit of trouble with my computers just recently, so I'm sort of in between two at the moment. I would really prefer to have everything on one, but it may be that there's a benefit in the future of, you know, using the two. But the disadvantage is that I can only get the emails on bernardilsley.com, and I can't actually look at emails that I've had during the day whilst I'm on this computer. I do know that Paul Angelo is emailed in regard to his show tomorrow evening, and I don't have it on this in this email address. And I've got into a habit of seeing the emails like that as they come in amongst many, and then thinking, well, you know, I'll have a little look later and read that out. So if you're listening, Paul, send me a quick one now to bernard@ilsley.com. I'll get that pretty quickly, and then I can read out exactly what you're going to be doing tomorrow night. But of course, Paul Angelo's shows are always on around about 9, start around about 9 p.m. GMT. And you know, classic hits and so on for the first sort of 20 minutes, half an hour, and then Paul gets into his in-depth talks about various fascinating and interesting topics, which quite often go on to 12 p.m. GMT, so they go on to midnight. And must say that if you looked at the program schedule, if you haven't looked at it for a bit, then you're in for a pleasant surprise, because Honey Malone has been doing a fantastic amount of research, and she's been helping to produce some fantastic shows for us in the future. And we have a number of future guests from particularly from the US that are going to be coming on, and really fascinating people. all quite different, and you can read about them a little bit on there. You can have a look at, you know, our regular guests that are also on there that, you know, I've mentioned many times here at Psychic Radio, and you can kind of see what dates and what subjects those particular people are going to be talking about. So have a little look on the program schedule just under King Arthur's table, on that little kind of sachet that goes across. Click on that where it says program schedule, and abracadabra. I don't know whether Dr. Royal would use those words, but seeing as he's got me into that kind of mood tonight, you know, we'll use it. I thought that the, you know, the Benny Hill music and the playbacks, the blah, 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 I thought, you know, absolutely great. really fascinating. But if you have a little look on the program schedule, you will see, you know, who we've got on there. And if you haven't looked recently, I would urge you to have a look, because you'll see what's going on and when in the coming months. We've had a tremendous amount of interest with regard to people, particularly from the US, wanting to come on to Psychic Radio to talk about their chosen and specialised subjects. And we're kind of looking into, at the moment, sorting out some jingles for these people, little adverts, so that, you know, we can put them on and you can hear their own voices and what they're going to be doing throughout the daytime and the night time. Because obviously Psychic Radio is played 24/7, 365 days of the year. At the moment, once in a while, Station 1's off and on during the day, not for necessarily long lengths of time, but again, that's due to the changeover from one computer to another. But, you know, when Station 1's not on, Station 2's on. With Paul Angelo, and shortly he's going to be also uploading some of the more recent programs that he's been doing, and also some of the more recent programs that other people have been doing. So we're expanding Station 2 to incorporate recent shows and other presenters, other guests I should say, because of course Paul presents his own shows on Station 2. So I'm just having a look down the emails at the moment. So just to remind you, if you want to send me an email tonight and want me to get it immediately, then you can send it to bernard@ilsley.com and I should get that quite soon. Otherwise, you know, you can send it to my other email address, and I will be looking at that shortly after the show tonight. So, you know, you can... you don't have to change the email that you send it to me. It's just, it's actually better for those who've got, that have got my other address, to send it to my other address. So it's better if you do that. But if you wanted to get through something urgently whilst I'm on air, the email address is bernard@ilsley.com, and anybody sending an email for the first time, bernard@ilsley.com is fine. You know, I tend to look there for people that are emailing for the first time. If you want to purchase the book Divina Spiritus, I must remind you that you can go to the shopping page here at Psychic Radio, and you will see the different chapters, the cover of the book. It's a hardback book, and you can order it online. So if you've been wondering where to get that from, then you can get it from there. So, just looking down to see if there are any emails in that I can read out to you. I don't think that I can, because I'm just sort of downloading any recent ones. There's quite a few to look through here, but I'm looking particularly for Paul with regard to tomorrow night's show. But, you know, in regard to next week's special guest... for next Thursday, if you're listening in, or you'd like to listen in on a Thursday, then you will see that on the program schedule. If you have friends that you think could have enjoyed tonight's show, then they can get to hear it again. It will be uploaded shortly in the next day or two. Jonathan's previous show is already uploaded and is played regularly at least once a day, along with other people that have featured on Psychic Radio in the past, such as Honey Malone, Paul Angelo, myself, Vilna Kimbri, Dave Roberts, and also, of course, Kathy and Rosemary Johnson. Kathy Embry, who specialises in fibromyalgia, Rosemary Johnson, came on and talked about, again, related health matters and issues. And I'm sure I've missed other people out. Of course, Karen Rule, who was hoping to get on last night. Unfortunately, because she's been on her travels, which tends to happen, she thought everything was set for tomorrow night. Come to phone in, and the phone died on her, you know, which can happen, you know. So, unfortunately, Karen wasn't able to get through last night, and she's sort of sorting another phone out and hopes to get to talk to us soon. So, we'll have to see what we can sort out there. But we are getting rather busy here now at Psychic Radio, and it's difficult to find, you know, the spots. So, hope you enjoyed tonight's show. I'm still looking down at emails, so I'll have one more look through here to see if there's anything about tomorrow night's show. Of course, it could be that Paul is out tonight. He does listen in most nights, but it might be that he's not available tonight. But I can tell you, if you've not listened to Paul Angelo's shows before, then you're missing out, because they're always detailed, interesting, and you know, he also adds a bit of humour into it. He's a different character to Jonathan Royal, Dr. Jonathan Royal, but he is also funny in his own way. We do like to, you know, when we're talking about things psychic and spiritual, which I think is important, we like to add an element of humour into it, because you know, it's a serious subject, and you know, life, especially, you know, the way it is today in our current economic situation, it's very difficult. There's a lot of stress and people going through a lot of pressure. It's nice to listen to something that's, you know, serious, that can help you, but also to have a smile, to have a laugh about it as well. I think that's important, because it lifts the spirits, raises the vibration, and that, of course, is very, very good for us mentally, physically, and of course spiritually. So I'm going to put on a meditation now to finish up for tonight, because we do tend to like to play a meditation each night, and I'm just looking for it now for you on the playlist. It will be the Golden Child meditation, played many times before. In this meditation, you can use it to help yourself with regard to healing. You can send healing to others during the meditation, especially if you know someone that really needs it. You can recharge your batteries. You can unwind, let go of tension, anxiety. You can also practice visualization, the development of your own intuition. And even, you know, if you're a little more advanced, you could get on to a little bit of astral travel and follow it through. So, hope you enjoy this if you've never heard it before, and if you have, which you certainly will have done if you've been listening to Psychic Radio, because it's played quite often, then, you know, follow it through. The discipline of doing it on a regular basis is also, as I was saying the other night, extremely important in regard to increasing your abilities to increase your attention spans, and also to be able to switch off the conscious mind in order for the higher consciousness to kick in and put you in touch with the universe. So meditation, as I've said many times before, greatly underestimated, and something that I recommend for many, many reasons. So I do thank you for listening to Psychic Radio tonight. You've been listening to Bernard Ilsley here presenting the show at Psychic Radio, and our special guest, of course, was Dr. Jonathan Royal, and he will, of course, be back again, as he enjoys his time on here, and we certainly enjoy having him on our radio. So a good night, God bless, and I speak to you soon.
Bring in lungs and anxiety, and to do that you need to tense up the body, and you need to bring that tension and anxiety to the surface. Visualize it as a color, as a grey or a green or a black or something nice and vivid. And as you do so, bring that tension to the surface and let it go now. Move the head in a circular motion, from the left to the right, from the left to the right, nice and slow. As you do so, feel some of that anxiety, stress and tension leaving the physical body. And relax.